Fomonetimo,
Yo Araya,
Araya, Mo, Nero Yaro, Nikabutengera se Palan.
Bema Egyptian Malaya,
Dabawa, Tibakundo,
Begare Zeline Rhodesia,
Dabawa, Tibakundo.
Fumonetimo,
Yo Araya, Araya, Ramo, Yaro, Nitabutengera se Palan.
Novo Fumonetimo,
Fumonetimo,
Yo Araya,
Araya, Ramo, Yaro, Nitabutengera se Palan.
Quando de Botara
Yara.
One, two, Debotara
Yara. Neso Zijabeza Ondo Zose.
Banana.
Banana. Banana. Nija Utengela Se Bana.
Banana.
Banana. Banana. Nija Utengela Se Bana.
Novo Fumonezi.
Fumonezi Mo.
Diyo Araya.
Araya. Fumonetimo,
Diyo Araya,
Araya Ramo, Nolero Nyararo, Nija Utengela Se Bana.
Ebizi Disaboti Etikota,
Nija Utengela Se Bana.
Ebizi Disaboti Etikota,
Nija Utengela Se Bana.
Banana,
Banana.
Banana,
banana, banana,
banana,
banana,
banana,
banana,
banana.
It's a great honor and privilege to have Russell Fulton with us today. Russell was one of the pioneers on our Fighting Men series. I think his last episode was episode 28. And that was quite some time ago. So if you haven't watched Russell's first episode, I suggest that you do that prior to watching this episode, and that'll give you a little bit more background, because Russell's going to fill in on some of the things that he touched on in the first episode. Okay, Russell, without further ado, I'm going to hand over to you. I believe you're going to start off by making some explanations and corrections with regard to that first interview that you gave.
Thanks, John. If I may, just as a precursor, thanks to you and Hannes for the outstanding work that you guys have done. I mean, recording our history is so important. You know, we see every week one of our brothers has passed on to, you know, higher authority. So, you know, I think what you do is highly commendable. So, you know, big shout out to you guys. And you know, as far as my first interview went, thanks to you for that excellent intro, the RAR regimental song, Sweet Banana, and the dedication to the men of the RAR. So if I may, I'll just show you this, hopefully. Can you see that? Okay, that's the RAR Regimental Blazer Badge. This was gifted to me by Jackie Kirang, wife of the former WO1 RSM Trevor Malcolm T. Kirang, DMM, ESM, and to all men who served in our regiment. So, yeah, I dedicate this interview to them. That's a very special piece, and holds quite a place in my home. So. If I can just go back to your intro there, John. just to give a little bit of clarity, it doesn't really matter. If people go back and listen to the first interview, I spoke following a question from Hannes about the songs and the camaraderie and so on that that we enjoyed in the RAR. And I spoke about after my first deployment, being handed two 4-litre chibuku scuds, which I downed. That was part of the platoon's acceptance of you as a platoon commander. And as I said, you know, it's not about me. I was initiated by my treaty. You know, a lot of guys weren't, but that doesn't mean to say that they weren't accepted. But in my platoon, that was a measure of their demonstration of acceptance to you as their ishe. What I omitted to say in the first interview was between the first and the second scud, I had to sing the RAR song, you know, Sweet Banana, because they wanted to know whether I was legit or not. And we had to know, but anyway, that was it. So you stand in front of all the boys, hey, I'm not going to sing it because I'll break the audio. But anyway, yeah, that's what I had to do between the first and the second one. So yeah, that went down okay. The other thing was, I mentioned to Hannes, like midway, three quarters of the way through, that 75% of our regular army were black soldiers. And by Hannes's response, it seemed to me like I surprised him with that. If you think about the RAR regiment, we had the 1st, 2nd, 3rd Battalion and Depot RAR. Outside of that, the regular army was not just the RAR. There were all the other corps and services. You look at RA Line, that's one battalion, SAS, one regiment, and armored cars, artillery, and so on. They all had a sprinkling of black soldiers. And then you look at the in-depth companies, and then later, territorial companies. That's why I say 75% of the regular army were made up of black soldiers. That's a simple reality.
Russell, if I just ad-libbing here, quite a lot of our viewers have asked the question, why haven't we, or are we not able to get some black RAR soldiers to be interviewed? And why haven't we been able to get more black? I think we only really had Taffy Matanodzi, which was a very popular.
Outstanding, yeah.
And hopefully one of these days we'll get Richard Nguyenya as well, who is quite high ranking in Zipra, who's quite good friends with Daryl Watts and Hannes. And hopefully we'll get Daryl Watts, Richard Nguyenya and Taffy all together in the same room or around the same campfire. Anyway, that's the plan. Is it difficult to... Are these guys who are still living there, it's dangerous for them to reveal their
Absolutely.
Identities and stuff?
Yeah, 100%. So, not to peddle Chibaya Moyo 1 and 2, the two books that Andy Telfer and I co-authored.
Why not?
Please, with the help of
peddle away.
Yeah, with the input of a lot of other good folks. We're in contact with a fair few former RAR soldiers, black soldiers. But there's a reluctance, not so much that they don't want to share their stories, but they fear recrimination, and that's the problem. You know, maybe some of those that have left the country, and there are a few that live in South Africa, you know, I'll contact them and ask them if they would be agreeable, and if they are, then I'll message you and I'll give you their contact details. I better not mention names on this forum, but you're happy to do that. But I know certainly within them, there's a very strong reluctance.
Yeah, understandably.
You know, I don't live there. You know, I haven't lived there for 20 plus years now. But who knows what goes on the ground? You know, one would have thought that after all these decades that things would have calmed down, but apparently not. You know, there's that deep-rooted suspicion that there'll be reprisals. I'll tap the ones that I'm in contact with in your neck of the woods.
Okay, Russell, in your notes, you talk about your acceptance and your baptism by fire, which I suppose is when combat soldiers are really accepted is after their first baptism of fire. And you talk about this 18-week job in Urungwe TTL. Do you want to tell us about
that? Look, it was that first bush trip, which was 18 weeks, my first bush trip with A Company 1RAR. As I mentioned in the first interview, we were bouncing around the country like a yo-yo, but we ended up at this point in the Urungwe. And our CSM, Yangama Kupara, who was awarded a BCR, one of the earlier recipients of that medal, he went to our company commander, who at the time was a guy by the name of Major Craig Beachel, who, if I remember correctly, was a former US Marine. He was on a short service commission with the Rhodesian Army and with A Company 1RAR, more specifically. He went to Craig Beachel and he asked him for permission to go on ops, on deployment with me. Yeah, I should just add here, you know, I listened with a great deal of interest to the last two interviews with Ray Harkinson, a good bugger. Yeah, I'm not that gregarious type. You know, I'm not shy and I'm not a shrinking violet, but I'm not like him. So yeah, if I have to refer to my notes, I understand why. So anyway, go back to this deployment. So he asked Beachel, can I have permission to go on the next deployment with the second Lieutenant Fulton? So of course it's granted. You know, this guy's got a Bronze Cross. He's been with the RAR for donkeys years. When I joined the battalion from regular cadet force, prior to that in the RLI, I never had rank. You know, I was a troopie. I was just a Bakshi MAG gunner. So this now, you know, you learn about command and control and all of that nonsense on cadet course. But once you're commissioned, you've got 36 men under your command that you're responsible for. So it's, you know, it's a deep end drop, you know, you sink or swim. And now I've got a decorated CSM in tow. He's got the optics well and truly on. So if you say that I was a bit nervous, would be an understatement. So it was like most of our deployments, 10 days patrolling, setting up ambushes, OPs, basic framework type operation. And we had, this is now in the Urungwe TTL, you know, the place that I visited pretty frequently, wall to wall, Zipra. And you know, you'll know when you came up against Zipra that you knew you were in for a shitstorm. So anyway, one of these punch ups, it was a fleeting contact. You know, in counter action, they broke, we firing, engaging. This guy, he's as thin as a reed, but one of the most immaculate WO2s that I ever came across. Ridiculous. The guy never smiled. That was just his way. Very quiet, but you could see in his eyes, no nonsense, but aggressive. So there's a lot of inbound fire. And Yangama just stands up, cool as a cucumber, removes his magazine, ejects the ball that's in his weapon, puts a ballistite cartridge in, puts a 42 Zulu frag grenade on the end of his rifle, pulls the pin, aims from the shoulder, fires, and he hits this Charlie Tango between the shoulder blades. We had another couple of punch-ups after that.
Did it detonate?
Yeah, it detonated. Yeah. I want to read his citation, if I may. Well,
just wasn't it after a 32?
Or 32. 30, I think 42 was the White Fox. Yeah, I might be right. Okay, so 32. Okay. Yeah, yep. Correct. So we have a few more punch-ups on that deployment. Go back to camp, get debriefed by Beachel. I go back to my tent. And about 15 minutes later, Yangama marches over to my tent, drives his foot in, salutes, and asks if he can have a few words with me. I said, yeah, you know, absolutely, come in. So he said, I'm here to tell you that you've won favor with the men of Simanje Manje. That was the nickname for altitude. Simanje Manje means the young ones. He said, you've proven yourself to them, so well done. Makorokoto Ishe, salute, turned around and was gone.
Wonderful.
If I may, John, I'll just read his citation, because what I told you about this rifle grenade, this is Kupara's way. Yeah? That's not a one-off. So I'll just grab it. Just 1 second. All right. So citation for the award of the Bronze Cross of Rhodesia, 19 October 1976. WO3 Yangama Kupara DCR has been continually involved in counterinsurgency operations since 1967. So this is a sequel of this guy. A total of 9 years. That was at the time. During this time, he has progressed from section commander to company sergeant major and has shown outstanding qualities of leadership and competence. Due to the shortage of junior officers, Warrant Officer Kupara frequently commanded platoons on operations for long periods with exceptional ability. In October 1974, he commanded 2 platoon A Company 1RAR when they had 2 very successful contacts, resulting in the death of 3 terrorist leaders and among 8 eliminations. On 7 January 1975, Warrant Officer Kupara was leading a patrol which had a fleeting contact with a number of terrorists. He carried out immediate and aggressive action and killed 1 terrorist personally by a direct hit with a rifle grenade. Since January 1976, A Company has taken part in fire force operations at regular intervals and have had notable successes. Several kills and captures were attributable to the courage, calmness, tactical skill, and excellent bushcraft of Warrant Officer Kupara. During a contact on 3 April 1976, Warrant Officer Kupara and his stick were pinned down by accurate fire by terrorists using an RPD machine gun. Warrant Officer Kupara threw a white phosphorus grenade and under its cover moved around beyond the RPD gunner and shot him through the head, killing him. 3 other terrorists were also killed in this contact. On the night of 6 May 1976, Warrant Officer Kupara was leading the lead vehicle of 2 vehicles carrying 2 platoon and company tactical HQ of A Company. When the rear vehicle was ambushed by 8 to 10 terrorists using RPG, RPD and small arms, the vehicle was immobilized and 1 section commander was killed on the vehicle. Warrant Officer Kupara immediately stopped his vehicle, which was out of the killing zone, and directed rifle grenade fire onto the terrorist position. He's got a thing with rifle grenades. Followed by an immediate clearance of the position. Warrant Officer Kupara showed a calm, professional approach and handled his men in an exceptional manner throughout. His determination and confidence had an excellent effect, especially upon the younger soldiers recently out of recruit training. He must have been somewhat shaken by the ambush and death of their section commander during darkness. Officer Kupara has a quiet personality, but is an experienced and well-respected soldier. His tactical ability and calmness in action are first class at all times, and he has displayed continuous bravery and competence on counter-insurgency operations over a long period. So, you know, when you hear about the heroics of a man like that, I mean, that's one of many. For me, you know, for that guy to come over and tell me that, you know, you've done okay and your men accept you, it was pretty big deal for me.
Absolutely.
So anyway,
just coming back to that Urungui TTL, was that on the escarpment, sort of below Marna?
Close to.
Yeah.
So it's right up.
Northern. Northern Rhodesia.
I think you've got a one in a million map or 1 in 500,000. But I've seen you bring up routinely on in interviews. If you have a look at that, it's getting up close to the escarpment.
Yeah.
The Wagamavura Dana, rather. Yeah.
Yes.
That was serious Indian country, that Zipra.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was during this bush trip, actually. I got called out of the Gangen back to Methuen Barracks to be the ensign to the regimental colour for the opening of the Zimbabwe Rhodesia Parliament. Yeah, and that, you know, apart from my commissioning and my service with good men, that's got to rank right up there as one of my proudest moments. You know, to be the ensign to the regimental colour is it's a great honour. Why it was me, I don't know. Maybe they didn't think I was doing too good a job on ops. Let's pull this rank out. And so anyway, I did drill rehearsal at Methuen with the escort party. under Trevor Curran, and then we had to board a train. And it's a big deal. You know, if you're traveling by train, your color party, they've got to stand guard around the compartment with fixed bayonets and ball up the chute. That color has got to be defended on threat of death. So anyway, we get up to Salisbury, get picked up. I was billeted at Cranbourne, RLI barracks. And the RLI ensign was Roger Carloni, DCR. I think Roger was in tree commander from then. We went through the paces under RSN Ken Reed. And then eventually the day came, 1 June 1979. So we get taken to our forming up place, which was about 10 blocks from Parliament. So, you know, whilst we're standing around chatting animatedly, guys were having a smoke, the regimental mascot, his name was Lance Corporal Nduna, gets brought over, you know, in all of his finery with a drape over his back, and he's got, you know, I mean, he looked like $1 million. So we all chatting, and his handler standing there and not keeping him under control. The next thing, I feel a plop on my jodhpur boot, on one of them, and it's our mascot, like loosened his bowels and trapped on my boot. Now, you must know, you know, how many hours were spent with kiwi water and you know, small circles to get those things to a mirror. Thank God, before I left, Trevor Curran, he took a shine to me. I don't know why. He said to me, "Sir, do yourself a favor, take yourself a pair of backup jockeys. You don't know. You know, you're going to be doing plenty of drill and the RSN Reed. You know, if one of your boots shoots a bolt, at least you've got a backup. So, you know, take." Thank God he said that to me, because, you know, what am I going to do now? March to Parliament with a steaming turd on my one boot. Yeah, I changed that. And anyway, then we were given the order to form up, and we marched down to Parliament. And 10 blocks is, I mean, it's not the distance. As the ensign, you've got to hold that pike like this with your arm parallel to the ground. 10 blocks at the quick march. You must know, by the time we ended up forming in front of Parliament, that arm going like this, being wobbly. So anyway, we form up, turn to the left, stand at ease, and then eventually the Rolls-Royce carrying the president-to-be, Josiah Zion Gumede, he had an MBE, this guy, arrives. He alights from the Rolls, and you know, very close to where the RAR detachment was. And bugger me, the guy gets out in his finery, and I see a powder blue something sticking out underneath his trouser bottom with paisley print on it. His pajamas. He gets out, faces the RLI, RAR, and then at the top end was the BSAP. And he received the presidential salute, 21-gun salute, and raises his top hat, and then promptly drops it on the floor. It was a disaster. Anyway, they, after all of that, like, horror, into Parliament building, where they do whatever the ceremony. I mean, we can't hear what it is outside. And guys, again, Ken Reed and Trevor Curran told us, you know, when you're standing outside there, because it was pretty warm, if you start to feel a bit lighter, then, you know, rock gently, you know, to your toes and onto your heels, gently, gently like this. Because if you just stand static, you're going to, and that's what happened, you know, head hitting the ground, and then what was it, St. John's ambulance running up with their stretchers and carting people away. So eventually, whatever is taking place within Parliament, the swearing in, is over, and we're standing and waiting, like, what the hell? apparently, you know, this is anecdotal. The president decided to go to the shitter. And he's got this guard of honor standing out there in the sun baking, waiting. And anyway, eventually he came out, he took the salute again, got into his rolls, and off they went. We were then, the parade commander was the late Major Brian, or Colonel Brian McDermott. So we march off, and that again was like hair-raising stuff. Once we got away from Parliament, then the RAR detachment broke out into our regimental song, singing, and, you know, the hair standing up. That's the last time that regimental colour was carried under a Rhodesian sky.
Sure. Yeah, amazing story, Russell.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I can remember once I did an opening of Parliament parade. It was in 1975, and Tim Beck's troop the RLI colours, or the Queen's colour anyway, at that parade. But I can remember also feeling a little bit faint, because it's a long time that you stand there,
yeah,
even though you're
time.
Standing at ease. You know, I had to twiddle my toes and do all sorts of funny things to try not to faint, you know.
Yeah, you know, there's a big difference, John, between doing rehearsals, dress rehearsals, and the real McCoy.
Yeah.
Because on the day, there are thousands of people watching you. So, you know, during the rehearsal phase, you're pretty relaxed, you know, and you know what to do, what to expect when. But on the day, you've got all these people standing around eyeballing, and, you know, you're a bit more tense, and I think that's what causes the problem. Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. So, do we move on to the next one?
Yes. Yeah, please do.
Okay, so I wrote about this one. It was in, or is in, Chibaya Moyo 2. And I entitled it "Of Pool Switches, Shato Ne Vavandiri Zakawanda," which basically means "of pool switches, python, and ambushes aplenty." So this incident that I'm going to tell you about happened on the 16th of August, 1979. Was my birthday. not the happiest birthday, but anyway. So again, we're patrolling in the Urungwe, on the western side of the Sanyaki River. Again, doing basic framework ops. So around midday, which was the way that we operated, you need to have a smoke break and a brew. So there was a bit of a rise in the ground, GTI as we know it, ground of tactical importance. So, you know, it dominated the river. So, you know, I put lookouts to the north, to the west, and the south. The eastern approach was, you know, we were protected by the river, so, you know, nobody would have attacked us from that point. And the riverine bush was really thick anyway. So this piece of ground, there's lots of pretty high grass bushes, and a lot of those sausage trees. I don't know if you remember them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So anyway, we move up there, and we get into all-round defense, and I take my pack off, my Bergen, and I'm leaning against one of these sausage trees, and, you know, laid my rifle down next to me and put my elbow on the top of my Bergen, and then I felt something taut underneath my right arm. So I look down, and it's a tripwire. So I followed the line of that, and on a small sapling, I don't know, 10 feet away, there's a pom dead too. So for people who are not familiar with what a pom dead too is, it's a stake mounted anti-personnel fragmentation grenade. This thing, it will do more than make your eyes water if it detonates. It's got a blast radius of around 50 feet, and you can set the tension from as little as half a kilogram to 6 kilograms. So I look down, follow this thing, and I decided I'm not going to be playing sapper today, you know, an engineer, and try and rearm this, because I went up to go and have a look at the thing, and the pin had almost been pulled from its housing. So I called to my men, I get up slowly, and then I pointed out this tripwire, and like, keep your eyes open and let's get the bloody hell out of this place. So anyway, once my platoon had exited I can't really call it a feature, this really a rise in the ground, I look back at this place with my platoon warrant with new eyes now. And then between the two of us, we saw a number of them. How the hell we never tripped one of those things, I don't know. No, I'm not overly religious, but I think, that day God was looking out for me. Maybe because it was my birthday. So anyway, sure. We buggered off from there. We found somewhere else where we could have a cup of tea without getting our asses blown away. And we did that. And then late that afternoon, it must have been 1600-ish, we patrolling in an extended line, and my right flank signals down the line that there's somebody suspect walking. So anyway, we go down into cover, and it's an AMA, African male adult. So we don't know if that's a Charlie Tango or a Sibby or what. I had a corporal who was the section commander of one of my platoons, big guy. He got up and as this guy passed and then knocked him to the ground and immediately put a face veil around his mouth, between his teeth, and then tied it behind his head like a horse's bit. And then we dragged him away from the park a couple of hundred meters, and then we interrogated him to find out what he was doing. And does he know anything about different? So, of course, we employ a bit of interrogation techniques. Now, one thing that I've always maintained in both of those books that Andy Telfer and I co-authored, I've never been a cruel person. I do what I need to do to keep my men safe, but I've never been cruel. This fellow, and he said he told us a little bit about where the Zipra mob were operating, what sort of dress they had, weapons that he'd seen. And he said, I know of an arms cache that's not too far from here. So I said, okay, you better not be bullshitting us. You take us there and show us now. So this is now, it's happy days. Now there's a payment now for my birthday. So we go to this place and then we arrive and he points to this hole, which looks like an old warthog hole. I said, right, well, if there's stuff in there, you better get your arm in there and show me something, Well, we're not doing it. You say that there's shit in there, you get your arm in. He lies on the ground. And you know what the warthog, I think it's a warthog, could have been an ant bear hole, I don't know. Like a shallow incline in like this. So he lies on the ground and he's easing himself up until his shoulder up to his neck and scratching around. Next thing he pulls out a case of 7.62 short ammo. And he grabbed a couple of RPGs and the propellants and one TM46 mine. So I said, check if there's anything else in there. So, he's got his head half in the hole now and pretty much as far as his shoulders will allow him to go inside there. And he's still got this face veil around his mouth. And the next thing, you hear this guy squealing like a little girl. And then I think, geez, maybe the guy's been stung by a scorpion or a centipede or there's a venomous nyoka or something in there. Get him out. I don't want any harm to come to this guy. I've given him a bit of a hard time with the water treatment and so on, but I don't want to harm him. He's produced the goods by showing us the arms cache is legit. So I told two of my guys, grab him by his heels and pull him out quickly. So they haul this guy out of the hole. And as his arm's coming out, now you can see what the problem is. It's a python. Has latched onto his forearm, and this is a sekuru, it's a serious bastard. So, I'm not about to try and unwrap these steely coils from his arm. So, and there's still a shitload of this nyoka inside the hole. So I don't know, this is several meters, this thing. I mean, it's a bastard. So I pull out of my pocket Rhodesian Army issue knives clasp for the use of, and I cut its head off while it was still wrapped around his arm. And of course then, because this thing is wrapped so tightly, you must know when that head was cut off, within seconds it looked like I'd been shot in the face with a 12 gauge. The blood was spraying everywhere. And you know, this guy, he passed out. So anyway, pull the snake out of the hole, unravel it from his arm. I removed that amputated head from his forearm, and I chuck it to the side, and then poured a bit of water on his face to bring him around, and a few claps on the cheek. Anyway, he wakes up, and then he turns his head, and then he sees he sees the python's head, and immediately he kisses out again. Anyway, I send my boss a sit rep, and he says, right, bring that stuff that you found in the cache, and bring that guy, you know, maybe SD can have a bit more of a chat to him. So the deployment's effectively called to an end. So we've now got to move from where we are to the nearest pickup point on the road, which is about 20 clicks away from where we were, which is not an issue. So we walk until around midnight that night, and then eventually, you know, we stop, and then we spur ourselves away for the evening. The next morning, we at the pickup point and waiting, you know, that old army cliche, a bit worn out, you know, hurry up and wait. Of course, wait. Eventually, the three platoon vehicles arrive, those MAP 75. So we bought. I always was in the lead vehicle. My PWO was in the second, and my platoon sergeant in the rear. So we've got to take quite a circuitous route back to where our company HQ is. So we're traveling along, and we're going through really broken ground. You asked the question earlier, you know, is that near the Mabura Donna? And there's plenty of tributaries there, you know, dry, but it's broken ground. I don't know. I think most of us probably have experienced or believe in whatever you want to call it, your spirit man, your guardian angel, whatever. My mum taught my butt and I from early age, if you hear a voice telling you to be careful, listen to it. You know, don't question it. Don't try and rationalize it. Listen to it. So we're going down into a riverbed, and you know, I'm looking at the ground around me, and I'm thinking, my God, this is not really the place where you want to have a breakdown or a puncture, because you're going to get pulled here. And that this voice is now talking to me. So I told my driver, slow down, and then I got onto the small means, and I spoke to my PWO and sergeant, and I said, I've got a bad feeling that we're going to get red. I don't know, 20, 30 meters after I finished that radio transmission, there's all manner of inbound. Small arms fire. I told my driver, put your foot down, get out of the killing ground, which he did. And so we're clearing, going up a bit of an incline, and the next thing, we get hit from a second ambush position. In all my years, I was never hit by two different ambush positions. So we go into the second one, and then the next thing, we take an RPG-7 straight into the radiator, and there's, you can hear the rounds hitting the armor plating. So I mean, you can't sit there. You've got to make a plan. My PWO and platoon sergeant are back just outside of the first killing ground. So those armor plating doors are flung open, and I speak to my guys, D-bus. We rehearse these things like over ad nauseum. So anyway, we did an encounter action, and flanking up the road, and my PWO had organized a fire group, and then he took his guys to sweep from the other direction. you know, we culled a few glipper. If I just go back to where all those tripwires and those pom twos were, when I saw these things and I realized the gravity or the danger that we had been faced with there, looking at that piece of ground, I chose that because of my training. You know, that ground of tactical importance must be denied to the enemy. If you dominate high ground, you can dominate the battle, control the battle, because you know, you've got better fields of fire. You can see what's going on. And then I realized how switched on these Zipra guys were. Whoever that commander was who decided to put those bombs where they did, they knew how we operated. These guys, if the army comes and they want to have a rest or they want to sleep somewhere, this is the likely place. So they were switched on. And then you look at that the vehicle ambush. To sight two killer groups, they must have understood what our IA drills were. So I've always, you know, not that I don't respect Zana. There were elements of Zana who, you know, would give you a good snotty. But in my experience, not on one occasion against Zipra did they not fight aggressively. So these were dangerous people. Yeah. So anyway, that was that little incident. If I may, John, you know, I spoke. Hannes asked me to if there was any RAR soldiers that I would like to talk about in the first interview, and I spoke about my personal Batman, Emmanuel Thomas Mukono, I nicknamed him my Mujiba, rather unkindly, but you know, that was his name to me. This is now a few years back. I was digging through boxes in our garage, documents and folders and this kind of thing. And I came across a powder blue envelope with a Rhodesian stamp on it and a handwriting that was very familiar to me. So I opened the thing up. You know, I can't quite place it, but you know, I know that handwriting. And anyway, I open it, and there's a letter penned to me by my Batman. When I was QRC of B Company 3RAR, he used to write to me fairly often, and I just read it. It's in Chibaya Moyo too. He says, "Dear Captain Fulton Ishe, this is Emmanuel, your Mujiba, sir. How are you, sir?" This is verbatim. Huh? "I am well, but I am sad because I'm not making your tea and talking shit with you, sir. I have been selected to go on junior leaders course, and I think you are the very one who put my name forward. Thank you, sir." He said, "I'm selected to go on parish course, but I'm afraid because it's too high to jump. But I remember you telling me, sir, when you were an RLI soldier, you did these things, and you also told me you were also a bit afraid. I remember you, sir. You always kind to me and you treated me like I was your mukamana, sir. I said, we killed a lot of magandanga together and that was nice. So I will get married when I will be going on R&R and I will call my son Russell. It is not a name we Africans know, but I'm like your son, sir. I'm DT Ishe. Please send me your picture so I can show my son and my wife also. Please write to me if you are not in the bush. Your Batman, Emmanuel Thomas Mukono, 3 Platoon, A Company, 1RAR. So,
what a wonderful
that was. That was that. And then, what happened? Was a few years ago. Canvas is the capital of the Australian capital territory. It's not that big, you know. If you look at Johannesburg and the Shires and so on, it's probably like that, maybe 35 k's from south to north, and I don't know, 15, 20 k's across. So I'm up on the north side of the ACT. I popped into a big supermarket there, Woolworths, and did a bit of shopping, and I go to the checkout, and there was a black man and what I presume to be his wife in front of me. So, you know, while they're loading the stuff and the cashier is scanning their stuff, I hear them talking to one another, and then my ears pick up. They were speaking to Shona. So I said, Pamsuru, excuse me, Kwazisa Shamwari, greeting friend. And then this guy looked at me and he said, are you from Zimbabwe? And I said, yeah, I am. So anyway, they finished putting their stuff through the register, and he asked his wife to take the stuff to their car, and he waited for me. When I was through, I only had a couple of things. I was wearing my RAR regimental tie. And he said, is that an RAR regimental tie, Russell? Well, no, we'd introduced ourselves. Sorry, his name was, no, I beg your pardon. We hadn't introduced ourselves at that point. He sees the tie and then asks me, is that an RAR regimental tie? And I said, it is. And then I said, Ini Indini Russell, or Nonziani. I said, I'm Russell. No, what's your name? Yes, like, it's Emmanuel's younger but Elijah. I used to, you know, when we came back from bush trips, quite often I would take Mukono back to his place in the township, and I remember his little book. Yeah, this is now, you know, many years after the fact. Yeah? So this guy says to me, he said, who did you serve with? And I said, I served in 1 and 3 RAR, but I was OC of 3 platoon, A company, 1 RAR in 1979, which, you know, when I was commissioned. And he said, my God. He said, I remember you. Said, I'm Elijah Mukono. My brother was your backman, and I remember you. You know, who would have thought, you know, over 40 years after the fact, Mukono passed away in 1980, you know, very sadly, that, you know, a chance encounter like that in a country, you know, half a world away from where we come from, that would happen. Just incredible. So, you know, I'm in confidence. And then he asked me, he said, did you know that my brother named his son after you? And I said, yeah, you know, in that letter. You know, life is sweet sometimes.
Are you in touch with young Russell?
Yeah, I am. No, I haven't. I haven't been. because he doesn't write. You know? He doesn't write. Some people are just that way, but... Hey, that like blew the wind out of my sails. Sure. I mean, he was completely shocked. When he turned to me, when I greeted him at the register, and I saw that face, there was something immediately that made my hair stand up. I mean, the similarity between them was quite striking. Just the most incredible experience, that, you know. A young bugger that I loved that I. And then meet his foot. Anyway, so I'm still in contact with his brother. He's well educated and doing extremely well in Sydney. So yeah, that's amazing, you know, how life works. You know, my platoon, I'm not going to mention my last OC, because this is, you know, I don't want him to take offense if he hears that I've mentioned his name, because it's all speculation. My platoon was not too keen on him, because 3 platoons, if ever there was dirt, 3 platoon was the lead platoon, always. And we hit mines like you don't know. I've hit more than my fair share of it because we were the mine sweeping platoon. My guys didn't like it. So we were based at this time at Wanda Airfield. And we've been doing patrols in the general environment. And we're leading up towards the ceasefire now. And you know, our Charlie Tango friends are all supposed to be within a matter of maybe a month or so moving in towards these assembly points. So I'm given the orders by my boss to go and pick up an elderly chap from CMED, the roads department mob, and go down the Bulawayo bike bridge road, take the turn off to Zazani Mission, which is just short. If you're familiar with that neck of the woods, it's near Mikado Ranch and the turn off to Taula. Pukki, I think from two engineers, I might be wrong, I think two engineer squadron from Bulawayo, Pukki with the mine detecting vehicle. We turn off the main drag onto this, it's supposed to be a road, but it's like so overgrown because of the wall. So I put the Pukki ahead of there were only two vehicles. I never brought my whole platoon. So one vehicle is debussed, flank guard on the left, and another on the right, ahead of the Pukki. And so, you know, I've got the Pukki chugging along, and I'm in my vehicle with this old roads department chap. You know, he was cucking himself, which is fair enough. I mean, it wasn't his job to be out there playing soldier, and he was scared of the obvious. And, you know, between Gwanda and the Colonel to the Zani, we developed a bit of a kinship there. You know, he was more like a fatherly figure to me. And I felt that thing to like look out for him. I mean, I would have anyway, but that's just kind of how that relationship developed so quickly. So anyway, you can imagine now moving along what's essentially a bush track. It's not a road anymore. It's overgrown and there's bloody blown up vehicles, you know, from donkeys years back on the sides of the road. So we chugging along, and every now and again the Pukki stops. I stop my flank guard on the radio to the Pukki driver. And after about, I don't know, 12, 13 Ks, from memory, about 30 Ks from the main drag to Suzani Mission, which was where AP Juliet was going to be established. So this old chap's got to recce the road to see what needs to be done, the low-level bridges and this kind of thing. That anyway, we get stuck 13, 14 Ks in, and the Pukki driver calls me to the front. Anyway, head up to where he is, and he said, have a look at that there in the road. And there's a perfectly cut square in the road. It's dirt road, not gravel, dirt road. About this deep. So I looked at him and I said, Chinese box mine. And he said, well, that's what it's for. He said, the problem is not so much the hole. The problem is, have they buried it somewhere else? You know, with a Pukki, there's many things that it will pick up, but it's not going to pick up a Chinese box mine, which for those who don't know, it's wooden. So
a metal detector can pick it up. Yeah.
So now it's high alert. So we chug along. Another one. So now, yeah, okay. Who knows what's coming? So we advance maybe, I don't know, 300 meters beyond that point. And then I'm sitting in the driver's cab. I'm not supposed to. You know, I should be sitting strapped in at the back, but I've got to try and navigate here. So I'm sitting next to my driver, and the 7.5s, they had those windows that were like hinged. I don't know if you remember the thing. They had like a barrel bolt basically that would keep them shut. So release that and open. I mean, this is October, so it's hot as hell. So I'm sitting there with one in 50,000 map sheet on my lap, and I've got a transistor radio against my leg and the left side of the vehicle, listening to LM radio. And I don't know if you remember Crystal Gale, the Serious Honey. She was singing a song that was top of the pops at the time. I'll meet you half the way. Go and listen to it on YouTube when we finished here. You, if you don't remember it, go and listen. I mean, she was a fox. I think I was in love with her. So she's singing quietly in the background, and we almost exactly halfway between the road and destination, designing mission. And the map sheet falls off my lap onto the floor. So you remember, I think it was more, it's a thought and not the practicality. You know, those armor-plated seats that we had in the driver's compartment and where we used to sit at the back there, they had that crap Carina carpeting or whatever it was, like offcuts to sit on. And you sit on that thing for an hour and you're going panga, but your arse is sore. So it's no different in the front. And of course, the lap straps that are supposed to keep you secure, it's a joke, these things. You kick them and you could push another person between you and the strap. You can't adjust them. So I've got this thing facile around my waist, but it's just a joke. So the mat falls on the floor. I bend down to get it. And as I'm out of my chair, left front detonation. Bam! My side. So I get blown clean out of the chair, blasted out of my chair. I'm turning in the air, and the back of my head catches that open armor-plated window, like a right angle, like straight into the back of my head. I'm pulled right out of the lap strap, and I'm upside down now on the floor. And if you've hit a mine before, there's dust and there's black smoke, and my guys in the back, again, part of the training IA drill, immediately open fire into the bush and expecting to be bushwhacked by someone. Anyway, there was nothing for coming. Self off the floor. And my first concern is for this old CMED guy. And I don't know. I know that I banged my head, but it wasn't not painful. I think, the old adrenaline. And you know what a head wound is like?
Yes.
I mean, it's impressive. You bleed like hell. And because I was upside down, the blood was like pissing down through my hair and all down my face like a curtain. The horror from a horror movie. And I'm like, my Batman sitting next to this old buddy. So, are you okay, sir? And my Batman looks at me. Jesus, say, are you okay? I don't know now, I'm not just, yeah. So anyway, long story. I radio my OC to tell him, look, this thing's a problem now. My vehicle, the vehicle behind can't pass me, and I'm not sending one vehicle on its own with the bookie for the other 15-20 K. It's a security issue now. So you better organize for a what the hell did they call them? Recovery vehicle. Yeah, thanks. You better organize one of those because this thing's not going anywhere on three wheels. And I've got to get, some of my guys, their backs were a bit buggered from the blast. And of course, this old chap, he's like seriously cutting himself now. So, and I said, I'll wait. I'll send my other vehicle and the engineer guy can go back to Wanda. And I'll wait for the recovery vehicle and then I'll go back with them and a couple of my guys who will guard the vehicle. So that's quite late that evening. We get back to Wanda Airstrip. And we'd been working with the para battalion, SA Paras. I'd been doing fire force with them. So my OC says, go across the runway, the starlight over there. Was a captain, a South African doctor. He's expecting you. So anyway, I go across there and got an order for 14 whatever stitches in my head. The next morning, into another vehicle with my same story again, back down to complete the mission, which we did. So that was that land bump experience. And then just to close off, two quick ones. But, my last chuff with one RAR, coincidentally. Now, the Paris have left, but we're still based at Wonder Airfield. My boss says to me, by which time? Sorry, we've got two Commonwealth Monitoring Force guys attached to our company. There was a captain from the New Zealand Army and a sergeant from, not that it's got anything to do with anything, but my understanding is that they were all bumped up a rank. So the corporal was bumped up to sergeant and this captain from a lieutenant to a captain, whatever. I mean, So these, I mean, they were okay, these two guys. Our men were very suspicious of them, you know, that there was ulterior motive. These people are not our people. We, you know, don't really know whether they're going to be selling us off. So there was a lot of mistrust there on the part of our agents. Anyway, Ron Marilia, my OC, says, get your platoon together. I want you guys to go and do patrols in the Dibili Shaba, and then towards where the Zani mission is. Now, every AP that was established had what they called a buffer zone, which was basically a 1 kilometer radius inscribed around the AP, which was no go for them or for security forces. That was just like, keep it clear.
What does AP stand for?
Assembly point. So, you know, when we had the ceasefire, our not so friendlies were told to move to these various assembly points where they'd hand their weapons in and then they wait for the elections and so on, integration and what have you. So, you know, we patrol and we were told basically that our former enemy, Zipra Zanla, and this Matabili land is Zipra country, yeah? So it'd be wider. We were told, these people have been told, and this comes now from Lookout Masuku, who was the commander of Zipra, and that bloody idiot from Zanla, what is his name? Do you remember his name? I forget now, brain farting here. Anyway, it doesn't matter about them.
Tongarara.
No, Tongarara was long gone. The name will come to me in a minute. Anyway, they were not in our area. These were Zipra guys. We were told basically that from Zipra High Command to Comops that the word had been put out to move towards the nearest assembly point. Now, this was not a request. It was an order from... The Zipra guys generally were disciplined, but we were told that there could well be groups that are hanging around in the areas armed that are going to flout the command for whatever reason. You know, and I can't speculate on that. We thought that maybe it was, you know, if things didn't go the way that they wanted when it came to election, that, you know, they would be armed and ready to start creating nonsense again. So we were told if they are not in the assembly point, we were given a drop dead date that these people had to be in the assembly point. If they're not there and you see them, engage them and do what you need to do. So that was part of it. And then the other part of the orders was to to patrol around the buffer zone, just to make sure that those folks that were in there were staying there. So this one evening, you know what Matabili land's like, eh? In summer, suicide month, October, it's hot as hell, 40 plus. I don't know, 1700-ish in the afternoon. Now, and the sun's still pretty high at that time in summer. We're moving, and the bush is thick as hell. So we walking two up and one back, our formation, along this track towards where the buffer zone is. And next thing, you know, that time of the evening, things become quiet, and sound carries a lot more than it does like during the day, midday, for example. And I hear that. It's like a completely unnatural sound. It's, as it turns out, the cloven hooves of donkeys at a full gallop. So I've told my men, get down and be ready. So we're watching down this dirt road, and there's like jetty bush, which is thicker. Around this bend, it's like a simultaneous sighting. There's this donkey cart being drawn by four donkeys at full gallop. It was almost comical. There's a guy standing there with the reins, and he's got a bloody a handful behind him. Like this, and his hat is hanging on the, under with his chin strap around his neck, like this, but hanging down here. It's like watching a Wild West movie, but it's the real deal.
So you broke up for a sec. He's got an RPG. He's got an RPG. Okay.
Yeah, he had an RPG, like on his shoulder, like strapped to him, and his hat is like obviously blown back and it's hanging on the chin strap here, and belting the donkeys. I mean, it was like watching a Western movie, but it's the real McCoy. So as they round the stand and we see them fully, my orders were always, I engage and then you go for it. So I pop the driver, and then the rest of my guys, they just they open fire. The sound of the gunfire in the still of the early evening, it was punctuated by the squeals and beating wings of alarmed Preston Franklin, when hearing all the shooting. after we finished shooting, their donkeys are down, these Charlie Tangos down. I told my guys, let's advance. So we skirmish past the donkey cart just to make sure that there's not going to be a counter attack from somewhere. Put my guys into all-round defense, and there's nothing. That's the end of the story. So we go back now. Well, I go back. Three donkeys were hit. So I did what I had to do. I shot it in the head. Not to be cruel, but what am I going to do? I can't call a bet out into the middle of the room. So I shot that thing, and there were three of these different guys that we slayed. The rest had gone like swastikas into the middle distance and never to be seen again. So we gathered weapons and got the bodies together, and obviously then I've got to get hold of Ron Meridia to tell him, look, you've had this encounter action, this is the story, what do you want us to do? That I'm not hanging around here, because I'm like 1 kilometer from where there's several thousand zipper guys. They would have heard what's going on here. So this is not like the last battle at OK Corral. I'm not going to take on half the zipper army. We're going to go and find somewhere safe. But we lost those three Charlie Tangos, and we bugged off a fair few kilometers away for the night. Next morning, first light, we go back, do a sweep around the area to check if there's any spoor, if there's been any other zipper activity in that area. It was clear. So the discipline, obviously, within that assembly point was pretty high. So I'm told then that, you've got to bring those bodies back because SD are going to want to Kangela, and we've got Commonwealth monitoring there left. So anyway, by the time my platoon vehicles arrive, it's midday, and these guys, these three, are like bloated toads now, and they run. So my guys say, Ishe, these bodies are not coming in the vehicle with us. I said, but they have to go. It's okay. We understand the orders, but they're not coming in the compartment with us. So they shut the door, they lift these bodies up, and they use toggle ropes and the like. So you three platoon vehicles, and at the back, you can imagine what it looked like. You've got three dead guys, like strapped outside the back door of each vehicle. So anyway, we go back to Gwanda Airfield, and these two monitoring force cars were falling over each other to get to me, wanting to interview me now, like, what the hell's going on here? Anyway, that I mentioned him earlier, Corporal Maumburuze Chipo, this big guy who's very well spoken. They interviewed me and him, and I didn't have to bullshit. It was what it was. So, they interview him first, they interview me, and our stories align perfectly. So that was the end of that. It was fun. Yeah, I think outside of Entebbane 1 and 2, that was the last jump in the Gangen anyway, for one area.
It's interesting that that we interviewed those Parabat guys, and you were actually involved with them at the same place. Yeah, that was also an interesting coincidence to me.
No, well, that's another story. I mean, I've got plenty. There's just one more now, which is...
Yeah, you had a last joust with three RAR,
hey? Yeah, well, that's a bit of a misnomer, actually, that little header. It was my first and only joust with three RAR, because essentially we were peacetime army. One day, I forget when it was. It was early 81, but the month, I can't remember. My OCU, first class guy, Marius Mayring, the former 2IC to Andre Benison, who was OC of A Company 2RAR.
I read his diary,
yeah. Yeah, Marius was a fantastic guy, very, very laid back, but clued up. South African. He was in SADF and then came up, did a national service cadet course and passed and then was commissioned and became. Marius is my OC. And when I arrived at Chipinga, we clicked immediately. It was just one of those things, you know, we were perfectly in sync with one another. Excellent time. So my captaincy had, I just come back from that attachment to the Brit Army. And Marius comes through to my little A-frame office and Sunray Minor, he never ever called me Russell in all the years that I knew him, not once. My name was Sunray Minor. Come through to my office, Sunray Minor. Anyway, I go through, take a seat. And now he's like all formal. I think I'm in the cuck. He said, you incorrectly dressed. Seriously? You know, I used to take pride, you know, in how I looked. If I was in camp, then my combat stuff would be starched and iron. Not I had kit for camp and I had kit for the Gangen. The Gangen stuff was, you know, worn and faded and whatever, but my what I wore in camp was like immaculate. And I looked down at my boots and I said, dust on my boots from walking through the MT maybe earlier. And then he just smiled and he opens his drawer. And he pulls out a pair of well-worn RAR captain's rank chiffons. And he tosses them, actually, no, just before that. Yeah, he tosses a signal that's come off the telex machine. Said, read this. So anyway, I like, scan through it and go to the bottom and like, go up and I read through it again. And it's a signal from Army saying that I'm promoted now from lieutenant to substantive captain, effective on whatever the date. And I, my God. And then he opens his drawer, then he grabs these worn 3RAR, not 3RAR, RAR captain rank slides and chucks them to me. He said, that's why you incorrectly dressed. Put those on. And he said, they used to belong to me. He said, put those on and join me in the pub. So anyway, I got dakwa that night. The next morning was a Saturday morning. It was one of the pleasures of being an officer in the RAR that you had a Batman. My Batman used to always, every Saturday morning, come through to my room at 0530 with a tray of, or ubiquitous tray of tea. And he came through this morning. And of course, my A-frame must have smelled like a brewery, because I got blacker cut the night before. And he took one look at me, put my tray of tea down, and then marched off. And then a few minutes later, the camp medic arrived, pulling a small little oxygen cylinder. There was a nail in the wall above above my head. Put the drip there, cannula into my arm, opened that thing full, and then put a mask on with the oxygen. Within half an hour, it was perfect. No sign of any bubble. A bit later in the morning, Marius calls me, and he said, I've just had a call from the BSA people, and there's a bit of a hana hana down at Mount Cylinder, which is a bit of a haul from Chibinga, that I want you to go and have a look. See, there's some MNR, you know, Mozambique National Resistance type banditos that are causing shit down there, you know, robbing stores, they are assaulting locals, raping women, and you know, we can't have this. You know? So go down there and go and see what you can do to sort it out. So anyway, I took a platoon and buggered off down there and met up with the local police guys. You know, by now, what we were used to were history. You know, they weren't there. Intelligence was less than reliable. So anyway, we get gather whatever entry can. We speak to some of the locals, and they say, yeah. No, they're definitely operating here. So anyway, we deploy, we cross training, and eventually we find tracks. And it's a pretty big group. But they must have picked up that we onto them. So they bombshell. So we follow. We can't follow all of them. So, you know, we follow this group into Mount Cylinder area. That place is, you know, if you want to use the term broken ground, that's broken ground. And it's a bastard there. Huh? Granite up, down, and yeah, it's tough. So we follow this this set of spore, and of course, it ends up leading into a bloody cave, doesn't it? I mean, why wouldn't it? And me and caves, always, if I knew that I was going into a cave area, we were going to have to clear huts or whatever, I always carried a pump action shotgun with a 12 gauge, the buckshot loaded. You can't be firing FNs and these kinds of things in the cave because you know, the likelihood is pretty high that you'll take yourself after the ricochet, never mind one of them. So anyway, we follow the tracks, and definitely the, you know, 3-4 of them have entered. So you know what it's like. Those things that you taught on recruit course, you know, how and why things are seen. Shape, shine, shadow, silhouette, sound, movement. If you compromise any of these six things, you've got a good chance of getting pulled. So now they are in the cave. They've got the advantage because they're in darkness, and there we are at the entrance in the light. We silhouetted, you know, perfect kill shot for them. Didn't know what. As you enter the cave, it's a bit of dog deck to the right. So, you know, they're further down in the dog deck. They can't see us, but I don't know that because it's dark in there. So I deployed some of my guys higher up in case there was an exit or exit point that you know, that they could maybe gap it from. Pop them off if they show their head. And you know, I've got to take care of what's in the cave. I can't send anyone else in there. That's my job. So there was a former two RAR corporal, a guy by the name of Bede. Marius Mary actually encouraged the guy to request a posting to three RAR, which obviously happened. So this guy is with me. I said, right, just the two of us, we've got to go and have a rec. So we're moving against the right-hand side of this entrance, granite, basically. So we, as we turn around the bend, there's a hail of fire. And Dere gets shot through the side. Fortunately, not fatal. It was serious, but not a fatal shot. So he falls down. He's in the open, and then he crawls on all fours. There's a, if you can imagine the lay of the ground, the floor, there's a bit of a boulder, and it's flat, and then it goes around to the right, and he's down there. So he's within the arc of fire. So there's dust blowing up and ricochets off this rock that he's lying behind. Oh, Jesus, you know, I can't leave this man now, you know. Next thing, they start throwing grenades, and, you know, this guy gets popped off. I'm okay because I'm around this side of the bend. So I had a bunker bomb. Boys carried one if I knew that I was going to be playing in cave. So I called to him, Bede, and I said, shut your ears, open your mouth. I'm going to toss this thing because I've got to do something to take advantage of the situation. So when I pulled out the pin, I knew basically where they were, and I chucked this thing. 3, 4, 5 seconds, and then bam, yes, you must know in a cave, settled a bunker bomb. If you don't open your mouth, you're in trouble. You've got to create that that balance, otherwise your lungs will come out of ears. So the minute that this thing detonates, you can imagine the dust from this cave. You think a smoke grenade's good, but now I've got to move forward. I can't see anything, but I know roughly where they are. So I start running forward and fire, pump, fire, pump, 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 pump. By which time now I'm out of ammo and I basically run into the back wall without even knowing that it was there. Slowly, slowly start settling. And there's a dead MNR guy, and there's two others that are moaning annoyingly to one side. So I called to guys that were like backing us. I said, okay, get Corporal Berry out of here and come and sort these guys out and take the stuff out. So they, we backed down to Mount Cylinder and we handed them over to the police, and that was the end of it.
Sure. Quite a story, yeah. Russell. It's funny, I grew up in Chipinga, so often on a Sunday we used to drive to Mount Cylinder and then go to Spungabera for Sunday lunch.
Yeah.
And have piri piri prawns and cashew nuts and Laurentina cerveja, that was a wonderful treat. Was to live in Chipinga is you got a little bit of Mozambican food, and
awesome.
I remember that Mount Cylinder forest and the big tree, and it's a strange country, that.
It's difficult. I've never ever been down that way until that day.
Russell, thank you so much for your time. I thoroughly enjoyed listening to you again.
No, you're welcome. Thanks very much, John.
Rhodesia,
Dagara, Dibagunda.